Bom, para mim é um particular prazer o seminário de hoje, obviamente. É para mim um seminário do coração, porque a Matilde, além de ser uma fantástica investigadora, é uma minha muito querida amiga e foi minha colega de curso no ISA. E já nessa altura, a Matilde se destacava, não só pelo seu desempenho, pelo seu desempenho, mas também pelo todo o empenho que ela punha em incentivar e ajudar todos os colegas, que é uma coisa admirável e que a Matilde mantém ao longo da vida. E isso para mim é muito interessante também. A Matilde tem uma carreira longa e apreciável, apesar de continuar uma investigadora precária, que é uma vergonha para as instituições, mas pronto, não vamos falar muito disso. A Matilde é investigadora do Departamento de Ciências da Vida e no Centro de Ecologia Funcional da Universidade de Coimbra e pertence também ao Laboratório Associado Terra, no qual o LIFE também está envolvido. E depois de ter obtido o seu doutoramento em Ciências Biológicas Aplicadas, nomeadamente em Tecnologia Ambiental, na Universidade de Gand, na Bélgica, onde eu tive o prazer de visitar, desde então tem desenvolvido a sua investigação toda numa tentativa de aperfeiçoar a avaliação de risco ecológico nas suas várias vertentes, não só no que diz respeito aos efeitos ambientais de fatores de stress, quer sejam esses fatores naturais, quer sejam eles antropogénicos, mas também nas estratégias de mitigação, de biorremediação. No decurso da sua carreira de investigação, eu acho que há realmente a destacar e a realçar o elevado número de publicações que a Matilde tem em revistas internacionais, com elevados fatores de impacto, Quartil 1 e no seu excelente índice H, mas também, particularmente, que eu acho que é muito importante e caracteriza muito bem o percurso da Matilde, a colaboração que a Matilde tem mantido com quase 200 centenas de investigadores internacionais ao longo de 17 países dos continentes europeu, americano e asiático. E essa colaboração é muito frutuosa e está refletida também no facto da Matilde colaborar na docência e também na supervisão de alunos de mestrado e doutoramento em muitos desses países. E, portanto, a Matilde tem uma carreira apreciável. E hoje, de certeza, que vamos aprender muito com ela, que nos vai falar do risco de pesticidas em organismos aquáticos. Matilde, muito obrigada. E vamos começar, e depois, no final, temos um tempinho para conversar um bocadinho, para comentar, etc. Está bem?
Ah, mãe. Então, a ouvir bem, não é? Preparei a minha apresentação para fazer em inglês, porque não, eu acho que hoje em dia nunca, há muito, o mundo é global também na ciência, e a probabilidade de haver alguém na audiência que se sinta mais confortável com o inglês é elevada. E eu própria confesso que às vezes me sinto mais confortável, porque as coisas estão feitas em inglês e a pessoa está mais habituada a ir a congresso e a apresentar tudo em inglês. Penso que isso não é problema para ninguém. Lembrei-me disso agora porque a Manuela fez a apresentação em português, na minha cabeça já estava tudo em inglês. Mas antes de começar, queria agradecer este convite, do LIFE na pessoa da Manuela. Que me honra e que também é com um particular prazer que aceito, dada a minha ligação ao Instituto Superior de Agronomia, como já a Manuela disse. Agradeço à Manuela as elogiosas palavras, das quais as únicas que eu posso atestar que são 100% de verdade é que fomos colegas de curso e somos amigas. O resto, fazemos o melhor que podemos. E pronto, realmente a minha apresentação é sobre a minha área de trabalho, embora seja de alguma forma simplista, pronto. Eu trabalho sobretudo na parte dos efeitos, da avaliação do risco, na avaliação do risco ecológico, não tanto na parte de exposição, e preocupo-me também sobretudo com o desenvolvimento de ferramentas que aumentem a relevância ecológica das nossas avaliações, porque quase tudo é feito em laboratório e, portanto, aliás, isso está no título da apresentação do webinar. As incertezas existem sempre. E então, o grande foco do meu trabalho, eu diria que era reduzir essas incertezas. Mas já vamos falar mais um bocadinho sobre isso. Acho que podemos passar então à apresentação. Vou então fazer o share screen. Aqui está. Tenho que tirar isto daqui. Para aqui. Pronto. Acho que já estão todos a ver. Pronto, então a minha apresentação já o título já tem. E agora vou passar para inglês. Since I consider that the professional background of the audience will be white, this webinar intends to present a simple overview on the risks of pesticides for aquatic organisms, mainly focusing on ways of reducing uncertainties in the ecotoxicity evaluations. I will start by a brief introduction on what is the risk of pesticide use and on procedures to evaluate that risk, the most common ones in a general way. And then I will go into more details into the how to assess the effects of pesticides on aquatic organisms. In fact, this is one of my biggest areas of research, so it will be the main focus of this presentation. And I will end by doing a small reflection on whether the tools we have available are really enough to reduce these uncertainties or whether we are neglecting some aspects. This will be made mainly by a specific example, which I intended to be most useful for an agronomy school, but there are other questions that we could pose in another webinar. So, starting very simply, we all have heard these words, hazard and risk. Some of us know well what they mean, but for many people, sometimes they are even used as synonyms, which is not really correct. When we are facing a stress challenge, which in our case today, we will focus on pesticides, but can be anything else, we are facing a hazard because a hazard is an entity with potential to harm. So a pesticide or a chemical has potential to harm. But are we facing a risk? Which is there a likelihood that this hazard causes harm? This is the risk, is the likelihood of a hazard to cause harm. For instance, this is a very simple drawing that you can even find in many books, showing that if a shark is swimming in an ocean, we are facing a hazard. The shark is a hazard. But there will only be risk if someone goes to swim beside the shark. Then there is a likelihood that the shark will cause harm to this person. Even if this likelihood is very high, there is always a chance that the shark does not attack the person. So the risk is a combination of the hazard and of the exposure. Pesticides are hazards because they have the potential to cause harm, but the likelihood of harm will depend on the exposure. And in the case of pesticides, we can simplify saying that this exposure is a function of the concentration, the persistence, the rate of degradation, and most important, of the bioavailability of the pesticides. So this is what the ecological risk assessment is about. It's a science-based process that can be used to evaluate the likelihood that adverse ecological effects can result from exposure to stressors in the environment, in our case today, from exposure to pesticides. This is ERA, the ecological risk assessment. And this process can be done retrospectively or prospectively. So we have retrospective ERA and prospective ERA. In retrospective ERA, the aim is to identify the causes for adverse effects, effects that have already occurred in the past or can even be currently occurring. This means that the chemicals are already being used and form potential problems in the water bodies. And we want to assess whether they really are responsible for the risk or are posing a risk. On the contrary, in prospective era, the aim is to assess the risks before the chemicals are placed on the market, they are released or are being used. So this is mandatory for newer products. Every time a new product is going to be marketed, it has to be subjected to a prospective era assessment. But this can also be applied for some substances that are already being used, that they already exist in the environment, for two main reasons. First, because they are old substances, so ERA was not required at the time they were introduced in the market. Or the scientific community has generated bigger data sets that justified that there is a new evaluation because they complete what was existing and show that there probably there is potential risk. In what comes at the regulatory level and within particularly within the European Union, I will focus more on the European Union when I talk about legislation. The ecological risk assessment of pesticides is ruled by four major pieces of legislation. The main one, which can be considered the umbrella of all the legislation, is Regulation 1107 from 2009 that concerns the placing of the plant protection products on the market. Plant protection products is the official name given to pesticides in general in regulatory terms. So you will be seeing it appearing during this presentation. Then we have Regulation 546 from 2011 that sets out the uniform principles for the evaluation and authorization of plant protection products. In fact, it sets out how to implement Regulation 1107. And then we have two Commission regulations, 283 and 284 from 2013. That set out the data requirements, one for active substances approval, when an industry or a company wants to submit an active substance for a pesticide, and the other one that set out the data requirements for the authorization of the plant protection product, because also the full formulated pesticide can also be submitted for approval. I wanted just to mention with regard to this regulation 546 that it sets out how to control the process of placing the plant protection products on the market. For example, an industry has to submit the dossier, and in this regulation they specify how to verify whether the dossier is complete, the quality of the data, or in case some data are missing, if the justifications for missing data are acceptable or not, etc. This is a general scheme for ecological risk assessment of pesticides. This process is regulated at national and international levels. There are several different regulatory ones, but they all come to this general scheme composed of three main phases. The first one is called the problem formulation. In this first phase, the sources, the stressors, the routes of exposure, and the ecological receptors that are at most risk are identified and are integrated. And this problem formulation phase, it's done by an intensive dialogue between all the interested parties, the risk managers, the risk assessors, and even the general public in general, through associations or et cetera. And this is very important because we all have to discuss what are the ecological entities that we want to protect. Even if the reason to protect them is simply for tourism purposes, for example, this can be a reason to protect an ecological entity. Then we have the second phase, which is the risk assessment framework. In this phase, basically, the risk will be characterized based on the assessment of the exposure and of the effects. And this is a scientific-based process. So it's done simply by the risk assessors. And finally, we have the risk management phase, which obviously is done by the risk managers. This is a simplified presentation of the process of ecological risk assessment, which is complex, is iterative, and it gives a lot of work. When we look at the problem formulation phase and looking at the major piece of regulation that I just mentioned, there is a high concern to protect the environment. However, they don't exactly say how this will be done. They only specify general protection goals. We have here an example in Article 4.3. They say that the pesticides shall not have an acceptable effect on the environment. This is very broad. What is an acceptable effect? It's highly discussable. So we need to specify protection goals that allow us really to protect biodiversity and the ecosystem services in the agricultural landscape and in the adjacent aquatic systems. And for various pesticides and various groups of organisms, these specific protection goals have been defined at the level of the European Food Safety Authority through their scientific opinions. And particularly for aquatic organisms, there is this document from 2013, which sets out these specific protection goals specific for aquatic organisms. And this is also a very good guidance document on how to perform the risk assessment of pesticides for aquatic organisms in edge of field surface waters that are those that are mostly at risk of when we apply pesticides in agricultural landscapes. During this presentation, many things I will talk about are based on these documents. Because the regulations I mentioned, they are regulations, but they are not very detailed in how to exactly to conduct the process. And these guidance documents are a huge help in that sense. So when we define the specific protection goals, this is just for you to have a broad idea of the process. We want to define what are the main aquatic groups of organisms, the main taxonomic groups that we want to protect, which are called the key drivers. Can be microalgae, can be invertebrates, can be vertebrates, etc. And for each of them, we also have to specify, to define which ecological entity we want to protect. For example, usually for microalgae and for invertebrates, the ecological entity we want to protect is populations. But when it comes to invertebrates, we might want to protect individuals. They start to become more important. And when we think about aquatic microbes, because the ecosystem service they provide are mainly the supporting and provision ones, we want to protect the functional group. And this column on the right is just an example of various taxa, various species that are recommended in the guidance document I just talked to you about. These are standard species recommended to assess how to protect these key drivers through these ecological entities by performing toxicity tests with these species. So then we have the second phase I talked to you about. In this phase, we need to characterize the risk and we will assess the exposure, which I will not talk about here, Emilia and Professor Maria José, that I already saw there, are specialized in more in this part of the risk assessment. They know a lot about this. And the aim is to calculate the time-dependent concentrations in the compartment water, or sometimes in the, many times in the sediments. We want to estimate a value, a predicted environmental concentration. So based on our models, because we use surface water scenarios and models based on good laboratory practices to do this in a step-by-step procedures, we arrive at what is the predicted environmental concentration for that product in the surface waters. And then we have to estimate the effects. So the aim is to evaluate the effects of this predicted environmental concentration on the aquatic organisms, either in individuals, populations, or communities, and to estimate what is called the RAC, which is the regulatory acceptable concentration. And this is done by conducting toxicity tests, usually in control lab conditions, but it can be also in SME field or field conditions, or even using models. And finally, we can characterize the risk. We divide the RAC by the PEC, so we divide the regulatory acceptable concentration that does not cause harm to the organisms by the predicted environmental concentration. And as you see, if the ratio is lower than one, there is risk, because the organisms will be exposed to a concentration higher than the one that protects them. And if it's higher than one, there is no risk. So this is a simplified way to show you how the process of ecological risk assessment works. And now I will go into more details in the tools available for the effect assessment and the rationale on which is the best to select to reduce these famous uncertainties. So this we already saw. So just to summarize the effect assessment, we want to evaluate the effect of the predicted environmental concentrations by measuring assessment endpoints that were selected during the problem formulation to best protect our aquatic key drivers. We will estimate the regulatory acceptable concentration for surface waters. We can do it in the context of acute or chronic effect assessment. Acute is associated to short term, most commonly to little effects, while chronic is more associated to long term tests and sublittle effects like growth, reproduction, although in present times you can have a chronic test that is also a short-term test. For example, I can evaluate the feeding rate of an organism by exposing the organism for a short period of time. So, going back to the focus of this webinar, ecotoxicity tests are the fundamental tool in effect assessments. They allow, we expose the organisms to a range of chemical environmental samples, in our case pesticide concentrations, because we want to estimate a cause-effect relationship between the concentration of the contaminant and the intensity of the biological effect that we are observing. And usually this is the type of cause-effect relationship we will find between the concentration to which we expose the organisms and the response we are measuring. And based on this cause-effect relationship, we can estimate different toxicity parameters. These two here, the NOAC, which is the no observed effect concentration, so is the highest concentration at which no adverse effect was observed, and the LOEC, which is the lowest observed effect concentration, meaning the lowest concentration at which an effect is observed, are classical ones that are falling out of use, mainly because they are not very robust, because they are estimated by univariate ANOVA, and they are highly dependent on the concentrations we chose to perform our tests. The most common ones in nowadays are these ones. The effective concentrations, EC, when we are doing a little test, is common to call it LC, the little concentration, that causes an X percent of effects on the organisms. For example, the EC20 is the concentration of the pesticide that causes a 20% effect on the growth of an organism, for example. It causes a 20% inhibition, or the 50% inhibition in case of the EC50. These are very robust toxicity parameters because they are based on regression methods and not on univariate analysis. So they are the most commonly used. And the other two I mentioned, they continue to appear because there are many data, and sometimes we even want to calculate them to have data to compare with literature, but they are more and more being replaced by toxicity parameters estimated by regression methods. For example, the LOEC, so it's the lowest concentration causing an effect, is being replaced by the EC10, the effective concentration causing a 10% inhibition of the response we measure. So it's practically a negligible effect, is very similar. So the problem is that most toxicity tests are conducted under laboratory control conditions. This is good because, as I just said, they allow the estimation of precise results and to establish firm cause-effect relationships. However, they are obviously conducted under unrealistic contamination scenarios. And this causes that there is a high uncertainty in the extrapolations that we have to make from the results obtained in the laboratory to predict the effects in real-world scenarios. This is why there is uncertainty is in effect assessment, because we have to do these extrapolations and this creates uncertainty. So this uncertainty between the extrapolation from results in the lab to the field scenarios is mainly associated to five main aspects. First, the alterations in the toxicity due to the sampling collection and manipulations. So when we collect samples to test in the lab, we are changing their physico-chemical characteristics. Then it's also difficult to simulate many environmental conditions, specifically in very dynamic systems like estuaries, for example, or when we want to extrapolate across geographic regions. Also, many times the organisms are exposed to contaminants in an irregular and unpredictable way. For example, in a river that receives effluents from different industries, we are not capable of knowing exactly when each factory will release the effluents, and etc. And also, most organisms are exposed to a multitude of unidentified stressors, which is also very difficult to extrapolate. And second, we use the standard species that I already mentioned, and sometimes they have low environmental realism compared with the real field conditions. So the big question is, which toxicity test to select? Which is the ideal toxicity test? The ideal one would be the one that involves all the biological communities at risk, but at the same time, allow us to reduce the uncertainties. As shown in this graph, so the ideal test will be the one that is conducted at higher biological level of organization, when we go from cellular to organism, population and community and ecosystem, because this allows to increase the ecological relevance of the test. The problem is that it also increases the costs of the tests. And moreover, when we go up in the chain of biological organization, we also increase the complexity of the tests. And the more complex the tests, the more difficult it is to interpret the results. And sometimes we are doing a lot of work, we measure lots of variables, we have many different organisms, and then we cannot interpret the results. So the advice is to conduct a tiered stepwise approach. We should start from simple and short-term tests and go to more complex and long-term tests only if we really need to generate more information. So this makes the ecological risk assessment cost-effective. We should not perform complex studies if we really don't need that information or if we will not be able to interpret it. Because many times when we start with a lower tier, we have enough information. So in the lower tier of testing, usually only standard test species are used. The idea is that the species that are selected, they represent the three major trophic levels. So usually we choose an autotrophic, which is a microalgae or a plant, which is an heterotrophic, which is an invertebrate, most likely a Daphnia. Daphnia is the most commonly used toxicity test organism in freshwater ecotoxicology since ever. And we should also use a predator, a vertebrate, which usually is a fish. In this lower tier of testings, there are various guidelines that are recommending a series of standard species from national organizations, international organizations like OECD, ASTM, ISO, etc. These guidelines, they give us the procedures, the recommendations on which species and on which control conditions we should use to conduct these toxicity tests. And just to give you an idea of the number of guidelines available, this is just for freshwater, several for algae and vascular plants, more than 30 for crustaceans, also insects, worms and snails, fish, and even for bacteria. And I just wanted to give you a very simplified idea. These guidelines are very simple. They give us recommendations on key aspects when we conduct a toxicity test. And just for you to have an idea, this one is an example from the little test with Daphnia magna and the guideline from the OECD, which is the most used within the European Union. In regulatory terms, they advise many times these guidelines. We can also use from ISO, but these are commonly used for pure chemicals, especially. So usually all guidelines are similar in these key aspects that they recommend us. They say which species they recommend, although they always say that we can use others that we find suitable. They tell us how to do the exposure conditions. For example, this is very important. We should use at least 5 concentrations to be able to estimate a robust toxicity parameter that I already mentioned. They tell us if the test is static or flow through, and the light and the temperature conditions, and also what's the duration of the test. This is very important. Then they say what we should measure. In the case of the Daphnia, just for curiosity, instead of lethality, they mention immobility, because sometimes it's difficult to distinguish, to be sure if a Daphnia is dead or not, because depending on the mode of action of the toxicants, the organisms can be immobile for a time and then suddenly they start moving or at least shaking. So they say we should measure the immobility during 15 seconds. If they don't move, it's because they are dead. And then very important, they all say which toxicity parameter we are going to estimate. In this case, the 48 hours LC50. So the concentration that causes lethality in 50% of the organisms after 48 hours of exposure. And finally, they all tell us a very important thing, which are the validity criteria to accept the test. Criteria that should be fulfilled within the control treatment. In this case, it's a little test, so it's only that we cannot have more than 10% deaths in the control, and the oxygen saturation should be higher than 60%. This is a good hint for us when we want to adapt these guidelines, because these guidelines, they are not rules, they are recommendations. If we want to change the species, to change the culture medium, to change the food we give during testing, it's fine if the test is valid. It's a good way to control if our adaptations are good or not. So, going back to our lower tier testing, these are the three most commonly used tests in the first tier of the effects assessment in the risk assessment. We do a sublittle test with the microalgae, which is only during 72 hours to estimate the growth rate. A little test with the Daphnia magna, I already mentioned, during 48 hours, and also a little test with the vertebrates, usually a fish, during 96 hours. This table is from the EFSA guidance document, telling us which species we should use in the first tier for active substances and pesticides in the acute assessments. And you see that here in orange circle are the species that are also in the data requirement commission regulation I mentioned before. However, they say that if the product has an insecticide mode of action, we should use an additional toxicity data from benthic organisms. So they propose us here also some standard benthic species that we should use in case we are facing a product with an insecticide mode of action. So it's more complete, but they include always the data requirements of the commission regulation. This is just to give you a short example of things we have to look at. In case of the chronic tier one assessment, the data requirements only require an invertebrate and an algae, but the guidance document from EFSA says that we should also include a fish in function of the persistence and bioaccumulation of the products. And again, sorry, if there is an insecticide mode of action, we should use a benthic organism. And also, if there is an herbicidal mode of action, we should use an additional primary producer, a macrophyte. These are all the tests we should do if we are doing the tier one for active substance or pesticides. So when we finish this, the question is, should we move to the next tier? Is the information we have enough to take a decision? Or we need to generate more information? For example, imagine we did tier one and we found that only one of those three organisms, like for example, the algae, were extremely sensitive and the other two were not sensitive at all to the contaminant, to the product. Maybe we need to generate more information to explore the sensitivity of that taxonomic group of the primary producers to best understand what's happening, if it's a specific sensitivity of that species or if that taxonomic group is really highly sensitive to the product and we need to protect it. So in this next year, these are the three most common toxicity tests that are conducted. In this case, we have a sublittle test again with the Daphnia magna, but in this time it's a 21 days reproduction test. We also do a sublittle test with the fish, but now it's a 28 days growth test. And again, if there is a suspicion that the product is toxic to benthic organisms because it will absorb to sediment, we should also include a sublittle test with a benthic invertebrate. We can do a 10 days growth or a 28 days emergence test with, for example, Chironomus riparius is an insect. I would like to give you a very fast and brief example of the importance of doing this battery of tests. They allow us to take much more information. This is, for example, a study that we conducted to assess whether the implementation of a secondary treatment would reduce the toxicity of a bridge cup effluent from a pulp mill. So for that, we selected a battery of different organisms that from different taxonomic groups with different key functions in the ecosystem. We chose a bacteria, a macroalgae, and a floating macrophyte, and also a cladoceran, the insect benthic, and the fish. All of these were sublethal assays because we knew that this effluent was not extremely toxic. These are the results of the physicochemical parameters showing that indeed, after the implementation of the secondary treatment, the major contaminants from this type of effluents, S1 is before the treatment and S2 is after, they really decreased. So lower total suspended solids, lower chemical and biological oxygen demand, and much lower absorbable organic halogens, which are the main contaminants in this type of effluents. And now here we have a summary of the results of the toxicity test we performed with the six species. For each of them, we determine the EC50, the NOAC, and the LOAC. And here are the results of the effluent before implementing the secondary treatment. What they show us is that the effluent was not toxic for all six species. In fact, was toxic only for three of them. And going into more detail, it was mostly toxic for the microalgae, because the EC50 is about half what was for the other organisms. So we need less effluent to cause the same effect. And now if you look at the results of the effluent after implementing secondary treatment, we see that indeed the toxicity was decreased. But what this study really shows is the importance of using a battery of toxicity tests. If you had used only, for example, the macrophytes, we would not have taken the same conclusion. So we can go on with next years. For example, we can do a next year, which is in the guidance documents, which is called refining the exposure lab tests. We keep on using standard species like the ones I just mentioned, but we refine our exposure conditions to be more close to the real world. For example, we can extend the duration of the tests. We can do post-exposure, especially in the case of pesticides. Many times the organisms are subject to post-exposures. They are applied two or three times during a crop growing, and there are peaks of exposure that then disappeared. So this is a next year and more complex toxicity tests. Then we can also move to a next year of testing where we use models. We use a species sensitivity distribution approach. This is simply a statistical distribution to describe the variation in sensitivity of an assemblage of species. We have much more data in this case, so we can do this species sensitivity distribution. Here we can have standard species, but we can have other additional species also. And we want to see which proportion of species is directly affected at a certain chemical concentration. So for all these species, for example, a toxicity test was conducted and we estimated the toxicity parameter. And the concentration that is depicted in the x-axis is referred to the result of the toxicity test we did. Can be the EC50, the LC50. And then what we want to estimate is to calculate the concentration that poses a hazard to an X percent of our community, because the idea is that this assemblage of species simulates a community. For the purpose of ecological risk assessment, an HC5 was accepted. So we want to estimate the hazard concentration to 5% of the species that we tested. So in fact, this says that from a community, if 5% of the species is affected, is not a very serious problem. Of course, we have to be careful because if 5% of these species are all from the same taxonomic group, we probably have to move to the next tier or to explore best what does this mean. But this is another way of do the risk assessment with much more data that we have available. And I could show you many other more things, but we can move just to give you an idea to the higher tier of testing, which is based on the use of model ecosystems, which are constructed artificially with samples that are collected from natural systems or by isolating portions of natural systems. They can be done indoor inside the lab or outdoor in the field. They can even be housed in artificial containers or enclosures, for example, that are above ground or below ground. The ones below ground have the advantage of controlling best fluctuations in temperature, for example, which are very important, especially in our climates. This figure on the right is the mesocosms we have here in Coimbra that we installed at the ESAC, Escola Superior Agrária de Coimbra, and we have been collaborating with them because they have space and we started to collaborate and we have installed these mesocosms there. This is a very typical figure in picture from the Netherlands, where they use these model ecosystems, which are experimental ditches, because in the Netherlands, as you probably know, most aquatic systems, they are reduced to ditches. So these are their typical model ecosystems. Of course, they have this type of model ecosystems have a reduction in size and complexity when we compare to natural systems, but they allow us to include assemblages of organisms representing different trophic levels. Very important is that when we establish these model ecosystems, we should give time for the communities to reach an equilibrium with the environment so that they are stable and they are as much as possible, very similar to each other's. And only after we apply the different treatments to the different mesocosms. So just to summarize, the effect assessment should follow a tiered approach. We start from simple and conservative assessment and proceed to more complex assessments if we need to generate more information. It's very important to keep in mind that all these tiers aim to assess the same protection goal that was defined in the problem formulation phase. We already know that lower tiers require less effort than higher ones. That's why lower tiers are more conservative than higher tiers, because in higher tiers, the aim is to be more realistic. We make assumptions more close to field situation and situations, and usually this leads us to bigger regulatory acceptable values. They are not so conservative, so the concentrations allowed, we will see that they are higher because we enter with many variables. And of course, when we go in the chain of complexity in biological organization, the succession of effects along this biological chain usually leads to a decrease in sensitivity. This is a scheme, general one, just to show the various tiers. We have to conduct them both at acute, for an acute assessment and for a chronic assessment. They all aim at protecting the same protection goal. And tier one and tier two, that are the ones I show with more detail. They are mostly based on standard species, although they also can use toxicokinetic or toxicodynamic models. Tier three, it's already population and community level experiments and also models. Whereas tier four, which is the last recommended, is already field studies at the landscape level and also models. And now I will go to the last part of this webinar to reflect about how trustable are all these tools and if there is more work to be done or at least more points that we should keep in mind. So the question is, can we really trust the available tools to assess the adverse ecological effects posed by the contaminants, in our case, by the pesticides? All the tools I have showed you, although we used, I didn't mention in detail because there is not much time, but after all this testing, we still use safety factors, trying to reduce the uncertainties and to be more realistic. The use of models and of this, for example, the HC5 also helps us to decrease some uncertainty because we are simulating a community. But is all this really enough? I will focus here on a big question. There are others. Through an example of studies that we have made, are there pertinent routes of exposure being neglected? Because not only the sensitivity of the species is important, but the routes through which the species are exposed is also very important. For example, for a benthic organism, is it through ingestion? Is it through adsorption of the pesticide to the skin, etc.? And for this, I want to explore an example. So there are guidelines on the ecotoxicological characterization of the soil quality. And here is an example of one, the ISO guidelines on soil quality. And we will see whether this guideline really protects aquatic organisms from the far-reaching effects of the application of pesticides on agricultural landscapes. So what this guideline says is that to characterize the ecotoxicity of a soil, we have to assess the soil habitat function and the soil retention function. The soil retention function is the ability of soils to serve as habitat for the organisms that live in it, the microorganisms, the plants, the invertebrates, etc. And this is usually assessed by performing toxicity tests with soil organisms using the soil. The soil retention function is the ability of the soils to absorb the pollutants in such a way that they will not be mobilized via the water pathway and translocated into the food chain. So this is evaluated by performing toxicity tests with aqueous alloids using aquatic organisms. So the soil retention function, in fact, reflects the soil leaching potential. If the soil retains the pollutants, they are not leached through the soil water pathway. However, pesticides can also be mobilized via surface runoff and leaching, not integrated in these standard procedures. This even though we know already that surface runoff is a major route of pesticide exposure in aquatic systems, mainly in tropical, subtropical, and even in our Mediterranean regions, due to the occurrence, which is getting even more frequent with these climate change events, the high occurrence of unpredictable heavy rainfalls after large pesticide applications makes that the contamination of surface waters by runoff is a severe problem. So the question is, do these alloids that are done by mixing a portion of soil with water are good enough to predict the effects of runoff on aquatic organisms? Do these tests really protect the aquatic organisms? So to test this hypothesis, we designed a study to simulate the risk to aquatic organisms due to alloids versus that due to runoff related pesticide inputs. And this study was designed to be simple, doing as a control contamination, although in a field, and using only one chemical, but we also wanted to be relevant. So we used a frequently applied pesticide, and we even went to the tropics where the risk of contamination by runoff is higher. And as you see here, in fact, this study was conducted in Costa Rica some years ago. So as a pesticide, we selected the organophosphate insecticide, diazino, because it's used in many Costa Rican crops like pineapple, which is one of the most cultivated crops in Costa Rica. And also because diazino is known to be of prime concern when it comes to surface water contamination via runoff in Costa Rica. Then what we did was we simulated the diazino spraying in the fields. And we sprayed at the recommended dose for pineapple and at 5 times the recommended dose, because we know not only there, but in many places, agricultures often misuse pesticides, increasing the application rates, although that is decreasing. And also, of course, we did the spraying in a controlled piece of land. Then after 1 hour, we collected the soil. We went to the lab. We did the aqueous elevates, which, as I said, we only mix water and soil during 24 hours. And then we centrifuge and we obtain these aqueous elevates with some total suspended solids. But in our case, we knew that this would not be a factor of stress for our organisms. And we tested the elevate toxicity by performing a reproduction test with Daphnia magna, but only during 12 days. We were in the tropics, so we had to work at higher temperatures. And of course, then they reproduce much faster. So it was enough to have results. Then we also did the field simulation of surface runoff, and we collected the runoff water. And we also went to the lab, and using exactly the same tests, we assessed the toxicity of the runoff water. And here are our results. But the result of the elevates of the runoff for the reproduction test, and we only used the cladocer and Daphnia magna. These are our values. So we saw that with the elevates, 8.3% of the recommended dose caused a significant effect on the reproduction of the Daphnia. Whereas with the runoff, only 0.4% of the elevate from the piece of land where we applied the recommended dose caused a significant effect on the reproduction. So we clearly see that the effect of runoff was much more severe than that of the elevate. In fact, the difference is around one order of magnitude. This means that if we really extrapolate the results from our elevate toxicity tests to see if our aquatic organisms are protected from surface-related pesticide inputs due to runoff, our uncertainty in this extrapolation is high, because runoff poses a much more toxic effect than the elevates. Then we did a similar study to assess the same hypothesis, but considering leachate-related pesticide inputs from the agriculture. So do the elevates predict the effects of a leachate? We conducted a similar study to compare elevates with runoff-related and leachate-related pesticide inputs. The study was simple, again, a control contamination, only one chemical, but we selected the frequently used pesticide and we also went to the tropics. And this time we did in Brazil. We selected the carbamate insecticide carbofuran because it's highly used in Brazilian crops, mainly in sugarcane, which as you probably know is a very common crop, intensive crop in Brazil. And also because again, this pesticide is known to be of concern when it comes to surface water contamination via runoff. We again simulated the spraying of carbofuran again with the recommended dose, and here with 2 times the recommended dose under control. After around 18 hours, we collected the soil and we took it to the lab to estimate the toxicity of the alloate. We did the alloate in the same way. And this time we performed only a 48 hours little assay with an invertebrate, Cereodaphne sylvestris, which is a local species. We also intended to increase the ecological relevance of the study. Then we also did the field simulation of surface runoff. We collected the runoff water. We took it to the lab to assess the toxicity of this water, and we did exactly the same toxicity test. And finally, we did the field simulation of leaching. We collected it, and again, to assess leachate toxicity, we conducted the same test. And here are our results for the alloate, runoff, and leachate. In this case, we assess the survival, again with the cladoceran, and I will show you the results of the acute toxicity test, the LC50 after 48 hours. When we compare the alloate and the runoff, here are our results. So the alloate, only 0.9% of the recommended dose was the LC50 for the alloate, whereas for the runoff, it was 0.1%. So there is a big difference, but it's not as high as we saw before in the previous study. It doesn't reach one order of magnitude. There is some uncertainty when we extrapolate results of alloate to the effects of the runoff on the aquatic organisms. But in this case, we can say that the uncertainty is moderate. And now let's look at the results of the leachates. The leachate was not so toxic as the runoff. So the difference between the results of the alloate and leachate is only 3 times, is not so big. And we can say that extrapolation results from the results of alloate to predict the effects of leaching on aquatic organisms, we can do it with a low uncertainty. So as you already saw, our main conclusion is in fact that routes of exposure are very important and we have to take it into account depending on where we are on our ambient conditions. And we know in this case that surface runoff is one of the greatest causes of contamination of the surface waters, usually is higher than leaching and alloate. So we should probably think about including it in some studies. In fact, we have developed some simulators to be able to simulate this kind of studies in indoors instead of really going to fields. This is a very pertinent route of exposure that is being neglected, and for some climatic zones is really important. So this is what I have to show you in a very short period of time, trying to make a big summary of relevant points and of approaches that we use not only in pesticide risk assessment, but also in general risk assessment, even in retrospective risk assessment, the tools are very similar. We can use these tools, and the approach is also a tiered approach. You can even use some of these tools for ecological studies. It doesn't have to be for contaminants. It can be for any stressor. So thank you very much for your attention. And if you have any questions, I would be pleased to answer.